Now, I'm going to break off the continuity of this story there to tell you something quite remarkable. Many years later, in peacetime, when we were well established at Jodrell Bank, which is I'm going to talk about later on, I went over to see our German colleagues who had built a radio telescope at Effelsberg near Bonn. And the director of that station said my equivalent there was Hackenberg. Now, Hackenberg, one or two of my Jodrell staff had got jobs there, and he was very pleased with the help they'd given him. And Hackenberg took us out to dinner one night, and to my embarrassment, the conversation turned to the war. And Hackenberg turned to me and he said, "Of course, I know what you did." I said, "However did you know that?" He said, "Oh, because I was a young man working in Telefunken in 1943, and I was sent to pick up the bits and pieces of your bomber. They called it Rotterdam." "Well," I said, "weren't you surprised at it?" And he said, "Not particularly." He said, we worked out what it was being used for, and we knew about the magnetron." Well, I didn't take much notice of this because I was then completely immersed in Jodrell Bank and an entirely different subject. But about 10 years ago, I'm now talking, you know, I'm really right ahead on a different part of my story. I received a message at Jodrell Bank from Wiebelinski, who had, Hackenberg had died, and Wiebelinski had taken over from Hackenberg, and he had gone through all Hackenberg's papers to try and sort them out. And he said, would I be interested in seeing a report marked highly, most secret, which Hackenberg had written in 1943. So I said, I'd be delighted to do so. So I received at Jodrell Bank, I think 3 years ago, I'm talking about 2003 or four, from Wiebelinski, this report, which Hackenberg had written in February of 1943, in which he had written a complete description of this equipment. And you know, when he reached the story of the magnetron, I could hardly believe it. I'm afraid I nearly fell out of my chair. He said, "It may be interesting to note that the magnetron is a copy of a Russian patent." So I found this unbelievable. Well, I just complete that little bit of the story. I eventually got the original Russian papers on this astonishing story, and it's perfectly true. In Leningrad, in early 1930s, they had a complete magnetron working on the same frequency that we were using and giving the same sort of power. Now, the remarkable question is, why didn't the Germans develop that magnetron and use it against us? Well, there are two answers to that question. First of all, it was one thing to get the magnetron working on the bench. In February 1940 in England, Randall and Boot, when they got theirs made, they got GEC to do a lot of extraordinarily brilliant work on it in the matter of sealing and making it into a vacuum tube which could be carried and used in an aircraft. Presumably the Soviets at that time had no reason for doing that. The other question was this, that I asked Hackenberg when I met him in the 1970s, why they didn't use the magnetron. And he said, oh, because we were ordered by Hitler to disregard it and carry on with what we were actually using. And you know, the amazing thing is that the same thing nearly happened in England. In 1940, when we were busy on the very elementary centimetre worth for travellers in Dorset, the Germans were marching across Europe and approaching Paris. And Rowe had an order from the highest level that he was to divert all his staff onto that which actually existed to make it work operationally. I don't think anyone at that time, neither in England, it looked as though, you know, we would never survive. And Hitler, it seemed incredible that he would not be the victor. They both had their reasons for getting on with whatever existed and not worrying about the future. Fortunately, Rowe had appointed W.B. Lewis, one of Rutherford's people, as his deputy before the war began. And Lewis persuaded Rowe to let this small group of us who was working on the centimeters carry on. And we did that, although Dowding, General Dowding, Air Marshal Dowding, the CNC fighter command, was brought down to see us. He preached to us about getting on with the 1.5 meter stuff. And we were there, we were quietly getting on with the centimeter gear. So there are those two reasons why I think that we, in the end, we were developed and used the magnetron effectively, and the Germans did not. Anyhow, that's the story of our crash bomber, and I did write a paper on that, by the way, which I might refer to later on. It was published only 2 or 3 years ago, and probably the last paper I shall ever write.